people to put forth the argument that the point of reference for the various emerging art form and other artistic practices in Malaysia derives its derives its origin or ideation from the Ramayana epic. So with the implementation of the National Cultural Policy in 1972 in Malaysia, it became a driving force for the nation state to safeguard Islamic religious elements and the Malay culture in particular. As such, cultural practices, elements and attributes from the Ramayana epic were Islamized to suit the local religious cultural setting. On a more serious note, the wayang kulit, which was a significant cultural element, was banned in the state of Kelantan that was governed by the Secular Islamic Party in 1990. Despite this obstruction and restriction, the influence of the Ramayana epic still continues in Malaysia today. And since 1960s, other art forms and artistic expression, such as painting, visual design, sculptures, digital arts, architectural designs, and more contemporary forms have sprung up in the local art landscape. Okay, so from the earliest and primary form where wayang kulit was made from leather and performed by the Tok Dalang, wayang kulit figurines and characters have been captured and presented in watercolour paintings by Nick Zainal Abidin. He was a Kelantanese who had early exposure to the traditional heritage of wayang kulit, and he was amongst the pioneer in transferring the wayang kulit characters onto paper, along which he highlighted socio-political issues in some work. He also related to his cultural heritage of his birth state in his work Puja Pantai, as shown, and even his personal battle with memory loss, which was portrayed with the use of Rama and Ravana. In his pioneering years, most of his paintings were based on wayang kulit characters or moments captured in the performance of wayang kulit. While in the final years, he managed to use his paintings such as this to reflect on the Malaysian socio-political issue. The essential characteristics from the wayang kulit characters, such as side profile posture, headdress, weapons, accessories that distinguish each character, are brought forward by Nick Zainal Abidin in his paintings. These characteristics and elements are such as the headdress of Rama character from the wayang kulit Siam. Presence of Hanuman, also known as Si Keraputi, who is Rama's loyal devotee and humble servant from the epic. The bow and arrow, which is a signature of Rama's weapon. The similarities of the costume for Rama's character in Nick Zainal Abidin's painting, which has been derived from the wayang kulit character. The upward bend gesture of the hands that eventually form a skewed cone from the wayang kulit characters are present in his character. So his paintings basically capture the characteristics of wayang kulit, such as styling, character, storyline that relates to the Ramayana epic. And this is not parallel with the implementation of the National Cultural Policy. Hence, only upon localization of the wayang kulit tradition, Islamization of the character, adaptation of storyline, injection of local cultural context, and even introduction of new characters such as Pak Dogol, the wayang kulit tradition was acknowledged to be more of a Malay cultural tradition and symbolism. So with a paradigm shift to the wayang kulit tradition, the localized wayang kulit was accepted and became the leverage for the creation of a multitude of art forms and artistic expression. this piece is from Syed Tajuddin. His grandeur and almost mythical-like painting captures the figurative style of the wayang kulit tradition. His choice of colors and the way he paints gives the viewer a magical, mysterious, and fantasy-like feeling. In a personal interview with Syed Tajuddin, when asked upon why he chose Ramayana in particular to be presented or imbibed in his paintings, he had responded by noting that firstly, it's our cultural history, and the Ramayana epic was something that was close to his heart, essentially because of the values and teachings of the epic. So again, we see side profile characters, elongated limbs, doe-like eyes, pouted lips, detailed garments, jewelries for the character, presence of nature as the background, and his blotches of rustic colors that blend into one another. So this is a plot from where Hanuman is being sent by Ravana to rescue Sita. So in the original story, Hanuman brings Rama's ring, but here he's being represented by a jewel. So moving on. So these are a few more derivatives of the styling that have been captured by other artists, such as in Chiang Sao Ling's Wonderful Life and Lu Fo Sang's Sunset series. So besides the distinctive wayang kulit figurization, stylization that are present, a much closer and deeper look into the content and context of this artwork is also needed. In Wonderful Life, Chiang's characters are portrayed with happy and smiling faces, and these characters are positioned to show an upbeat movement. The characters can be seen to be in a celebrative mode as they gather around to dance and share the joy. Effects close to smoke or clouds engulf this painting that gives it a magical moment touch. However, in Lu's festival dance, there's a sense of seriousness due to the choice of darker shades and the staticness of the characters in it. It projects a much more serious tone with the main character, which is larger than other characters and in a much more presentable garment, staring and searching into the distance. The secondary characters appear much smaller, with normal clothes rugged down and in a position of offering gifts to the main character, which can be presumed to be the dalang. So two dark shadows are present in the background, and could this be read as spirits? Also, the offerings, one pigeon on each hand of the female secondary character, the presence of fish and also flying fish-like character are present in this composition. This can be associated to the offering practice during the wayang kulit performance, as noted by Sweeney, that the most significant role of the dalang with magical religious capability was as a spirit medium, which is known as the berjamu session. So on a closer inspection, the context of both these artworks, celebration in the former and magical religious in the later, must not be forgotten, as these different contexts can be established in the performance of wayang kulit in a traditional setting. And it is these purposes, to celebrate and to heal, or spiritual refinement, that is respectively shown in the context of Chiang and Lu's paintings respectively. So both Nirmala, and I'll show you another artist, Norma Abbas, do not only apply characterization and stylization, but went a step further to adapt the storytelling technique of the wayang kulit, such as the casted shadows of character on screens to their works. So I mean this of casting of shadows. So Albeit the figures take a departure from its traditional form, Norma's both female figures are facing each other with a pop-like and groovy finishing. These side-profile female characters with emphasis on their eyes and mouth cannot be disregarded of wayang kulit origin. Norma's painting illustrates the scenario of how Malaysia and Indonesia can be same yet different in a given time due to historical roots. Titled Indo Connection 2, the artwork also literally portrays the roots and links between Malaysia and Indonesia, whether it's its people, culture, arts, or history for the matter. The unmistakable pucuk rebong design usually found on batik is present on both the garments of the characters, and yet batik is another significant cultural icon that is shared both by Malaysia and Indonesia. Furthermore, adapting the wayang kulit style to depict such content even strengthens the context of the artwork, as wayang kulit tradition in Malaysia is known to be a mixture and assimilation of the wayang kulit tradition from both Indonesia and Thailand. So So similarly to that, Nirmala has adopted the side profile and elongated limbs of the wayang kulit characters into her figures here, Margaret Thatcher and her US ally Ronald Reagan, to bring forward her socio-political consciousness. Unlike Norma, Nirmala juxtaposed newspaper clippings with representation of her subject as wayang kulit characters painted in acrylic to create a collage. At the back of this wayang kulit like characters, there are shadows, look like monster, that are derived from wayang kulit characters to depict the real personality of the represented characters. The injection of non-Ramayana storyline or even a new character is not alien to the wayang kulit tradition, as the new interjections are common methods used to educate and raise awareness among the public. Even though in the collage Friends in Need, Nirmala raises socio-political awareness on issues abroad, nevertheless, it provokes the viewer to ponder, analyze, and perhaps question their very own political agenda that they face at home. So first, I'm going to talk on the one you see on your left. Raja Lope comes from Bruas Perak, which is the old Ganga Negara kingdom of Hindu Malay origin, and draws inspiration from this history in order to create his paintings. Inspired by the rich local myths and legend, he captured his dream and wild imaginations into paintings of wayang kulit characters, kuda kepang, and such, that are juxtaposed with local cultural elements such as batik, keris, toman fish, and even racial symbols. However, his painting does not project an ancient feel, as his wayang characters are made to look robotic with a touch of futurism, as he has done with his local fairies. Talking about his paintings, Raja Lope highlighted about the importance of being aware to protect our culture and world so that the mythical elements and legends will continue to live on and become an inspiration to dream and live. So talking about the next artist, Tintoy Chua uses the elements from the wayang kulit to recreate contemporary characters from movies or even festival, and these are known as fusion wayang kulit. Okay, he works with a local puppeteer to custom design this character. He explains that the fusion wayang kulit project was initiated during a designer weekend back in 2012, where he and Tay were driven to create contemporary Malaysian character for the exhibition. The very first Star Wars-inspired characters were Perantau Langit, Luke Skywalker, and Sankala Vader, Darth Vader. So eventually, more characters such as Hulubalang Empire, Tuan Putri Lia, you see here, yeah, Tuan Putri Lia and the Stormtrooper. And even they had the small R2 were added into the collection. So working with Pak Dayan as the puppeteer and Azrai for the translation of the script, the Peperangan Langit made its debut in Kota Baru in 2013 and received an encouraging and hyped response. Elaborating further on the character design, Tintoy explains that the character designs for the Peperangan Bintang series were inspired from the Ramayana epic. Princess Leia has been localized and customized according to Malaysian culture. Her character design is essentialized heavily on the wayang kulit style. Side profile figure, her both hands. So if you look at Tuan Putri Lia, basically it takes reference from this Sita Dewi here. So if you can take note about the headdress, the accessories on her shoulder, positioning of her hand, and here Sita Dewi is positioned on a naga. But here, Tuan Putri Lia, you will see how it's been. Sorry, yeah. So here she has the lightsaber, she has her batik, headdress, accessories, and she's positioned on a stormtrooper. Okay, yeah, I'm coming towards the end. So the next one is talking about Pohon Beringin. So the vitality of the semangat that was initially represented by the use of Pohon Beringin leather puppet is captured and still present in various other art forms in current times. So the repetition of distinguished Pohon Beringin shape, that looks like the tip of spade from a card deck. Okay, in a variety of stroke sizes and colors are captured by Fatima Cik in her batik piece titled Pohon Beringin. The interlocking of tip of spade shapes with other patterns and elements in artwork portrays the presence of the spirit that is tightly woven in the traditional folk beliefs and ritual practices in the Malay tradition and Southeast Asian's consciousness in general. So moving on to the next one. In Liu Kung Yu's Cemerlang, Gemilang and Terbilang, Liu composes a digital montage using Photoshop based on different Malaysian icons such as the Proton Car, Petronas Twin Tower, First Malaysian Astronaut and the word Merdeka. So here, it combines into a pohon beringin shape, but when with the light is projected through this thing, you get a shadow of Ravana on the floor. Yeah, so that's so. Yeah, coming to my conclusion. So in reality, the epic has gone through transformation and localization, emerging in diversified versions, complexities, and series. As such, can the Ramayana epic be disregarded with the varieties that are existent and that will emerge in future, which will not be exactly identical to the original epic? The various creative expression and ideas that have emerged, are these to be considered as a series of falsification of the Ramayana epic? To begin with, change is inevitable in every aspect of our daily lives, whether it's arts or cultural practices or information and technology or even to our belief and thinking. Adaptation and customization is vital so that we fit into current times and make progress. This is similar to the Ramayana epic written more than 2,000 years ago. It cannot and will not make its presence in its entire originality and volume. Nevertheless, the variety of version and series that continue to exist doesn't necessarily mean it's a form of falsified truth either. So, this is my last statement. The Asian context must not be viewed similar to the Western context. Asian historiography is rich and complex, and thus, socio-cultural setting, geographical location, historical roots, different religions and its teaching, cultural practices and tradition, political, economic trade, and even elements of myth and magic must be taken into consideration in regards to art historical research. Albeit various interpretation, art forms and creative expression derivating from the Ramayana epic has surfaced in different contexts and volume from the original epic. This, however, does not falsify the truth of the Ramayana epic in laying the foundation of Southeast Asian arts, culture and historical identity of its people. The fact that the Ramayana epic is still referred to only proves its significance and as an umbilical cord to the arts of this region. Thank you.